Good morning, everybody. We are going to open our inaugural session. I request Professor B.K. Sharma sir, AD NIDM Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal ji, Shri Upmanyu Basu ji, Joint Secretary Department of Animal Husbandry, Ms. Bharati, IG Forests, to please come to the dais. I request Professor Anil Gupta as well to join us on the dais. With the permission of the chief guest of this inaugural session, we open the inaugural session. I request Professor Anil Gupta to set the context for the program. Professor Anil Gupta.
Very good morning. Suprabhat, namaskar. A warm welcome to all the dignitaries and guests. I would rather say dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, because this subject is so important that each and every delegate of this workshop is a valuable resource for us. This subject, which is of immense importance, somehow the mainstreaming of this theme into the disaster risk reduction has been little inadequate, and the initiative of the NIDM under the leadership of the new executive director, Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal, has given us an insight and motivation to foster the academic endeavors in the subject. I welcome you all in this one-day consultation workshop. Consultation workshop, we have named it like this because this is a subject which is highly interdisciplinary. We require the inputs and insights from various kind of stakeholders, various thematic areas, various disciplines, various levels of the government, the national government, various ministries, state level, and also the local level, and the civil society organizations. So it is indeed our honor that we have the experts on the dais, which are representing the key ministries: Ministry of Environment and Forests, Ministry of Animal Husbandry, which deals with livestock, and the state government, which is the key player in managing the disasters. So we have Professor V.K. Sharma, we have Mr. Basu from Ministry of Animal Husbandry, and we have Madam Bharati from Ministry of Environment and Forests. The key stakeholders and the apex agencies like NDMA, India Meteorology Department, and various other international agencies are also participating in this workshop to make it a fruitful discussion. As I have been asked to set the context, this workshop is going to focus on both the dimensions, the livestock and wildlife, and beside this, the animals in captivity, and therefore we will be discussing the issues about zoo also. Here, I would take the opportunity to refer to the Darwin's theory of natural selection, and which has been used to refer as the survival of the fittest by the Herbert Spencer, and that has been later countered by using that it is not the survival of the fittest, but it should be ideally the survival of the fit, because the survival of fit also refers to the coexistence. And that refers back to our history, which is filled with the incidences and the victorious stories where killing of animals has been considered as a kind of a matter of prestige and praise. So we have destroyed the animal kingdom. We have enjoyed the impact on animals for quite long time because we have considered animals as a resource for human being, human pleasure. But now the systems are changing. Now the thought process is changing. Now looking at the impact of disasters and impact of various other stresses on animals, now we have realized that animals are the valuable resources of human development and human sustainability. So we are now trying to emerge as people for animals, or we for the animals. And therefore, this subject on animal inclusive DRR emerges as very, very important dimension of the holistic and inclusive disaster risk management. Some of us may recall a small video which used to come in television few years before, that if the tiger population is lost, we are going to suffer major urban floods. And seldom people might have related these two issues. But now, in the scientific world and also on the policy dimensions, we have recognized that how the animal populations are not only the sufferers of disasters, but also the loss of animal kingdom, or the loss of biodiversity in animals is also going to contribute to the increase of intensity and frequency of the disasters. So it's a two-way relationship that we have to look at. Animals are highly valuable, but they are differently vulnerable also. So we have to look at this issue. Although thoughts on animals and DRR has been there at various forums, I myself recall just 10 years before, when we were writing an article for animals for DRR, my own team opposed myself that why we are focusing on this subject. But now this subject is getting recognition. The last point where I would like to refer here, that for the past 15 years or so, we are witnessing a very, very serious global slowdown. And the past 2 days news that we are witnessing what is happening between various countries, people are talking about the Third World War, or so many things that also somehow relates to the economic slowdown. People are looking at some kind of advantages, direct, indirect, and there are diplomatic implications of the economic slowdown. And that relates to the 2005 Millennium Ecosystem Assessment that had referred that it is the ecological slowdown that is contributing to the sustained economic slowdown. So now this is the time we have started looking at the ecosystems and nature-based solutions as one of the critical remedies to address our disaster risk and also to reduce the impact of disasters, and therefore the consideration of animals has become a forefront issue. The cyclone Fani and cyclone Phailin and recent Kerala flood, there has been significant impact on animals that has also been referred with the outcome of PDNA exercise also, but quantification in terms of death and damage to animals is lacking. We have to work on those directions also. So with this, I consider that with inputs from all fraternities and all the fractions of the government and society, we'll be able to come out with some important ideas to take this issue forward. And I welcome you all once again. And I congratulate my colleague, Mr. Ashish Panda, who has, under the able leadership of the new executive director, we have taken this subject. And with the support of all our colleagues within the NIDM and outside the NIDM, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Gupta, for setting the context in the right perspective. Now I request Shri Manoj Kumar Bindalji, Major General, our AD, to address the audience in his welcome address.
Jai Hind to everyone. I welcome Ms. Bharati, IG Forest, Ministry of Environment and Forest Services, Shri Upmanyu Basu, JS, AHD, Professor V.K. Sharma, who has been associated with NIDM since beginning, and all other delegates who are sitting in front, who are known in their own fields or who are actually dealing with this subject. So heartiest welcome to all of you once again. We all know that animals, both wildlife and livestock, face the brunt of a disaster and are often left out of the whole DRR process. I remember that in any of the responses that I used to do, and whether it be a floods or earthquake or landslide, the least priority was given to an animal who was being seen. In Srinagar floods, while we had finished rescuing most of the civil population, then we ventured out into some areas, remote areas. We found a dog yelping, stranded on one piece of log, and he had been there for nearly 96 hours. The challenge for us was that our boat could not go near him to take him onto the boat or to feed him, because he was so angry and so scared, that particular dog, he or she, I don't know, but was so scared that it was not allowing anyone. So finally, they had to tie some food on a pole and then drop it. So slowly, slowly gain his confidence, and then it was rescued. But this all happened by chance. Again, no thought was given that we are going to rescue an animal. It was just that during the beat, an animal was seen. So that is the negligence that is there in the society today, that the least priority is being given to any animal, unless those who are like our pets or who are in our livestock, with whom we are able to earn our livelihood. So there is an urgent need for bringing this awareness among all stakeholders, right up to the community level, that we understand the true value of protecting wildlife. And there is a need to coexist in this whole ecosystem. The Sendai framework also calls about protecting the livelihood and production assets, which includes livestock, working animals, and the associated items. But these sustainable goals to be achieved, it is important that we realize the importance of these animals in our ecosystem, and we take steps of mainstreaming their well-being during disasters into our policies and plans. Recently, we have seen in Australia, live example, and there's no better time to hold this particular consultation workshop. Millions of animals have died. And how many, day before yesterday or yesterday's news was, 1,40,000 animals have been saved. Out of millions, which is less than 0.1%. Less than 0.1%. There was no capacity, there was no handling capacity. When the whole thing started, people just assumed that they will move from this side of the forest to the other side of the forest. When the fire spread to the other side of the forest, they assume they'll move somewhere else. As and when the enormity of the bushfire started increasing and it started becoming engulfing, the reality dawned. But then there were no handlers. How do you handle a wild animal? We are constantly at war with the wild animal. They don't trust us, we don't trust them. The trust deficit, you cannot overcome in 1 day or 2 days. Why a wild animal, even a stray animal, you cannot approach it so easily. So these are the major issues which have not been thought about in many, many, almost all countries. How do we deal and save these precious lives? And to top that, if we are not careful about protecting that ecosystem which includes the forests, it is creating its own weather now. In Australia, they have gone into a vicious cycle. The fires is creating a firestorm, which is creating fire, more fire. It is spreading it all across. So many issues are coming up time and again, which is increasing the vulnerability of the animal. So we, that is why we thought that it is very important that this consultative workshop be held, and in which we call all stakeholders who are dealing with this issue, so that we come out with some action plan. In this workshop, we are aiming to brainstorm all these issues. There are basically two sessions, mainly one is wildlife in open and wildlife in captivity. And the second is dealing with livestock and stray animals who are roaming around the streets. We have kept pets out of it because pets are looked after because they are considered as part of the family, and hence they are always looked after. So we need to identify the gaps, areas in this whole process, which needs to be covered. And we need to identify the stakeholders and the various stakeholders for whom training modules is required to be made, or the capacity building is required to be done, or policies or research is to be formulated to help out in mainstreaming animal inclusive DRR in every ministry, every department, and every community member. We have seen so many initiatives have been taken all across the world, like Bhutan. They are in the process of joining all their forests. They've got 7 major pockets, 5 are major, 2 are minor. Now they're creating corridors of forest between the forests. So all these will be connected. Already the process has started. They're very strict to ensure that no construction is done, no linear construction is done. If there's a linear construction which has to pass through, because once you connect all the forests which are on the periphery, how do the people move? They're creating walkways, overhead bridges for the animals to cross. So they have gone in a big way. So there are various means of protecting the wildlife by migrating them from one corner to another, by allowing them more space, marking of waterlogged areas. Every year there is a waterlogging due to incessant rains. It may not lead to flooding, but that gives you an idea as to where, which is safe and which is unsafe areas. There might be a policy that we extend the forest to some higher places also, so that there is a place for the animals to move if there is a flood. So such innovative approaches have to be seen, and the main issue is their census, because now in Australia, they're talking about more than 500 million animals have died. There is no credibility to this data because there has been no tagging. Tagging has been done selectively to study certain species, but the whole wildlife has not been tagged, and hence how much have actually been killed during this bushfire, no one knows. Zoos, they are also doing a lot of innovative jobs, but then again, it has to be done very intelligently. Miami Zoo, they catered for cyclonic storm, so they created stockpile, a building full of stockpile of medicines and food and all other things that are required to keep the zoo animals safe for about 1 to 1.5 months. The storm came and that building collapsed. Again, they were back to square one. So now what they have done, they have put it on mobile vans, and which they have kept outside the zoo, 2 counties away. So there are ways and means where we can help them. We cannot just raise our hands that it is beyond my capability. What can I do? There's always something which we can do. Livestock, the major problem comes in urban areas when there's a flooding, and the complete livestock is also present somewhere. In Srinagar floods, we had, there was a goshala next to an army camp. So due to the floods, that army camp, Tattu ground, that is the location, Tattu is that army animal, mules. The wall came down, so there was no barrier. So from that goshala, about 60 to 65 cows, they swam across. And there were 3-4 disused buildings in our area. They climbed. One of them climbed up to the 4th floor. There's a classic photograph in Srinagar where that cow is looking out of the window of a 4th floor, and you can see this bust of the cow. And it was a big task to get her out. Because from 4th floor, how do you get a cow down to ground floor? 1st floor, we broke open the windows, and with the help of cranes and everything we did. 2nd also, we had the cranes for that. But 3rd and 4th floor, it became a big task. They were not ready to come down the steps. So there are many associated issues which come. And then 2nd is the waste. Because of the water, there is no disposal of the waste. And now, if these animals drink that, human being is careful enough not to drink that. But what do they do with the animals? No one caters to them for water. What we are seeing in Australia, that a cowla is being fed, it's a one-off case where a wild animal has come up to a human being and they are being given water. But there's no plan to give them fresh water. So the number of diseases that come out to the animals, that also needs to be looked into. So there are so many issues that we need to deliberate upon. I've just listed out a few based on some experience and some news, local news. So the whole aim is that this one-day workshop will help us to develop an inclusive, sustainable, and disaster-resilient framework, which we need to follow, which will then follow up with the respective ministries and collaborate with them to ensure that AIDRR, Animal Inclusive Disaster Risk Reduction, is mainstreamed into our society. And it is catered for during any disasters. Orissa is a good example, where when they did the mass evacuations, they also evacuated the livestock along with them. The number of deaths of livestock is minimal in Orissa in Cyclone Fani, including zoo animals. So I look forward to a very stimulating and consultative discussion in today's workshop. And I'll request all of you to contribute freely. We have kept the sessions very loose in the sense that speakers are also there and we have enough time for questions and answers. So anyone, everyone who has got an issue should make it so that we mark it down as one of the requirements that is to be done. With this again, I once again thank all of you for coming and participating in this workshop, and which is being held by Professor Anil Kumar Gupta and Dr. Ashish Panda and their team for planning the whole thing and conducting it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ED sir, for your insightful and encouraging opening remarks and welcome address. We are lucky to have Shri Upmanyu Basu ji, who is Joint Secretary, Department of Animal Husbandry. I request Mr. Basu to kindly address the gathering. Mr. Basu.
Good morning, everyone. I should begin with thanking NIDM, Major General Bindal, Professor Gupta, and IG Forest, and Professor Sharma. To begin with, disaster management has really improved over the years in our country. However, we have somewhere, I feel, faltered in considering animals with us who are proving to be a major source of livelihood. But thanks to NIDM and thanks to the organizers of this conference, so that it actually comes out with a lot of food for thought, so as to how do we protect these livestock resources. Livestock, I will include poultry as well. We have separate authorities, separate capacities, each of them they have. But then they are all like the five fingers of our hand. Everybody knows where to bend, but unless we come out as a hand, it's very difficult. And in this respect, I should be really thankful for, you know, being a not only a coordinator, it's bringing us all together. Because disaster does not differentiate as to which ministry it will attack, or which this is the work of this ministry or that ministry. And then my short stint with animal husbandry, you know, it's all started with World Veterinarians Day. I think there is one veterinarian whom I know from here. Yeah. So they used to say that animals are dumb. Only veterinarians can understand them. But now I think everybody else can also understand them. So we should have, I mean, this capacity building. Because, you see, when we talk of agriculture, dependence of rainfall, right from our school days, we have been hearing the same old story. But with livestock, things are much different. You see, person not having enough land, but having a couple of livestock can still survive the drought many times. If you take statistics, persons committing suicides, farmers committing suicide, not a single of them have owned livestock. They are totally crop dependent. Higher yielding crops, whatever you may call it, with high input cost, and then lay going into a debt trap. But this livestock resource is much of a low input cost. Of course, there are challenges presently for fodder, for feed, no doubt about it, and then animal disease, because I happen to be from the ministry looking after animal disease. And crisis management is one of the main thing there, because bird flu, I think some people will talk about zoonotics. Bird flu comes from there, avian influenza. Now, point is, we have had a disaster management plan, but I think that it requires much more revision. Capacity building is one of them. And one area where I would like to emphasize is effective communication. Because any disaster, when it strikes, everybody gets, you know, flustered about it, don't know how to go about it. But unless there is a proper communication from the proper authorities who are well capacitated enough, then things can, you know, you can think rationally then as to how about going on. And the second thing is early response, which means that, because you see, we've been, it's an age-old wisdom that animals sense earthquakes, animals sense onset of, say, floods. Animals, they sense it. So can we do some, take some knowledge from that particular thing and then go ahead with having our, you have to coordinate, like we have satellite pictures coming in, then that has to be coordinated well here. In animal husbandry, we do our own work, okay, livestock production. And after every floods, there is going to be increase of leptospirosis or any other, flood-borne parasitic diseases. And many of the diseases can come to humans as well. And then like in Australia, actually, if you summarize the whole thing, it is man versus animal going on because of all these things. Because even yesterday's NDTV news said that 10,000 camels, which they had got from Afghanistan and India, they are going to be shot because there is scarcity of water. Now that's another extreme. But here, because livestock, like small ruminants, they act as livelihoods of our, because more than 70% of our farmers are all unorganized, small, depend on livestock. So unless we do this protection. So I have a small suggestion here that, you know, like whenever there is some disaster, it is better to free the animals from their shackles. If they are tied to some pole or something, the first thing is just free them. It's not that not freeing them will protect them. Rather, freeing them will protect them because they have their own instincts. At least they can come up to a higher ground. This is especially in case of flood. And then making available fresh water all the time. They can survive without food for some time, but water is very essential. And then, of course, protection. As we protect ourselves, we should protect them as well. But then to understand all this and in a proper way, the capacity building is a must. And that's why I thank NIDM once again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Basu sir, for highlighting the importance of livestock in our rural economy and why that is important for AiDRR. Thank you so much. Now I request Ms. Bharati, IG Forest from Ministry of Environment and Forests, to kindly address the audience.
Professor V.K. Sharma and other distinguished delegates on the dais and other participants, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to all. First of all, I would like to thank the authorities and the organizers of NIDM who have invited me to be here in the inaugural session. Disaster, I mean, it's a subject which affects everyone, be it human being, animal, or other living creatures, and even the non-living organisms. It's a coincidence, as Major General Bindal was saying, that we have scheduled this workshop when there is a great bushfire in Australia, where the witnessing of death of so many animals expected or estimated to be in millions. People say that it may be due to animal ranching, but yet to be proved. We all know that disasters, they put hard-won development achievements of ours at risk. They reverse the economic growth and the progress we try to achieve as human beings in eliminating poverty. Sadly, the climate change is making it worse. Nowadays, we see the climate-related disasters are more frequent, and they contribute enormously to economic losses and population displacement, animal death also. So disaster risk reduction is not only about protecting human lives, but taking equal care of animals, villages, cities, ecosystem services, whatnot, water regime, climate, catchment area, natural resources, etc., etc. So this is now the DRR, in short, what is being used nowadays, is firmly on the radar of all the governments. We can recall the Sendai framework for DRR, which is for 15 years from 2015 to 2030. That is the first major agreement of the post-2015 development agenda. It recognizes that the states have the primary role to reduce disaster risk, but the responsibility should be shared with other stakeholders, including local governments, private sector, and other stakeholders. So we all know that it has got well-defined targets, 7 targets, 4 priority for action, and I'm sure those things are going to be covered in today's consultative workshop. Though this is a non-binding and voluntary agreement, but it is recognized as being closely linked to development. Since I am from Ministry of Environment and Forest, and given the time limit, I will restrict myself to forest fire. I could have spoken on hazardous substances also and air water pollution, which is a very general subject, but I'll restrict to forest fire being a forester and from Sikkim. So just to initiate that, how much pressure the Indian system as a whole, our government system as a whole is under to deal with any kind of resource crisis, because we only account for 2.4% of the world area, but support almost 17% of the world population and 18%, we all of us know, 18% of the world cattle population. And on top of it, if I talk about the forestry sector, the forest, we are approximately 25%. And our one-third population is partly or fully dependent upon the forest. So you can think about, the forests are also, at places they are in large patches, but at times it is quite interspersed with the habitation. So the kind of pressure we deal when we manage the forest fires, and forest fires are a regular phenomenon in our country. And the season, all of us know, February to June, it is peak. Every year we face forest fire in large areas, but still we are able to manage it. We don't have that kind of animal or human losses, except in few cases. If we recall 2016, what happened in Uttarakhand and Himachal Pradesh, last year in Teni in Tamil Nadu. But normally we are lucky also that our almost more than 36% of the forest areas are not, they don't have any incidences of fire. They are not exposed to fire of any significance. But around 54%, we can say 55% of the Indian forests are exposed to occasional fire. Very few area in India, around 2.5% of forest area is having high incidences of forest fire. So our approach is mostly this centric to those areas. But forest fire being, there is a difference when we talk about forest fires and management of forest fire. If you see other kinds of disasters like flood, earthquake, urban fire, that we are more concentrated or focused on taking care of the natural resources. We care our natural resources. We ensure that there is a least damage to natural resources. Animal rescue becomes incidental in general. So it is understood that if there is a forest fire, which is controlled, automatically the possible damage to the animals will also be controlled, will be minimal. So to take care of this emergency of forest fires, so our ground forest force, who take the lead? In case of there is any need or major forest fires, police forces, local villagers, and even NDRF and army also come to our rescue. It depends upon the duration and intensity. I recall the management of forest fire when I was a district or divisional forest officer in Sikkim, long back in early 90s. At that time, we were managing forest fire in isolation, taking the help of our forest staff and some local villagers. If it is a major forest fire, which is very close to the urban or any habitation village area, then police force was taken care of. Partly the reason being that Sikkim is a difficult area where there was not much of road network in those days. But there is a significant shift in dealing with any kind of disaster. Now disasters, all kinds of disasters are taken into totality. And today is the, I mean, we can witness this by having people from many disciplines here who are going to talk about disasters in one. In forest, we have a very scientific management plan on forest fire that is called National Forest Fire Action Plan. NIDM, NDMA were always there with us. They were there with us when this is being prepared, and now also in preparing our crisis management plans. But in those plans also, we have given more thrust upon having awareness to villagers and the local communities on this disaster, as well as our training to the frontline staff. This is one aspect which we are going to discuss today. I'm happy to inform the House also about how advanced we are in forest fire monitoring system. We are one of the first five, I can say, major countries. We take care of drone or satellite surveillance.
Shri General Bindal, ED and IDM, Shri Basu, Joint Secretary in Animal Husbandry, Ms. Bharati, she is IG Forest and belong to Sikkim cadre, and I am also working in Sikkim in different capacity. Friends sitting in the audience, you know, Professor Amita Singh, Professor Amarjeet, our senior officers from NDMA, Joint Director NIDM, my colleagues from NIDM, friends. I think at the outset I will compliment NIDM for this initiative. And if I say that this initiative, in this name particularly, you know, the animal inclusive disaster risk reduction, this is very important, because I remember that Professor Anil Gupta, he is doing number of courses which is related with ecosystem-based disaster risk reduction. And when we say ecosystem-based, I think definitely it will be animal inclusive. You cannot ignore animals, you know, they are part of it. And but I think giving this title, you have emphasized, you know, more, which Professor Mr. Basu was mentioning, that now the focus is very clear, you know, that animals, they should also be given due importance when we are talking about risk reduction. I think my previous speakers, you know, they have given beautiful examples that, you know, whenever there is any disaster, natural disaster, and nowadays you are seeing that with climate change, this climate-related disasters, they are increasing. Their frequency is increasing. Floods, droughts, forest fire, you know, these are very, very common. I am working in Sikkim, and I know that the frequency of forest fire has increased, you know, in last couple of years. And we are facing this problem that not only forests, but the animals which are living in the forest, they are also affected. Of course, the example of Australia, which is given by General Bindal and Ms. Bharati, 5.3 million animals, you know, killed in few days. And this is the official figure which is released by them yesterday. But I think unofficial figures say that it may be up to billion, you know, animals. In India, we have seen in Orissa Super Cyclone, that was our first interaction. And we realized that we are really ignoring animals. And when the national park, you know, the animals, they came out, and most of the animals, you know, they disappeared. And that was the first time we could see that how important is this subject which we are ignoring, and we will have to include it, you know, some or the other way. Indian culture, you know, because floods and droughts, they are our normal thing. Whenever we talk about Indian natural disasters, we always talk about floods and droughts. And I think all drought-affected states in this country, they were having this provision that whenever there is drought, you know, they will have animal sheds and all the gaushalas and all that, you know, they become active. When we're talking about relief, the relief is given, you know, for the animals. And some of these states like Rajasthan, Gujarat, they have done remarkable job, you know, in this direction. And whenever there is these disasters happen, I have seen, you know, in 2002 droughts of Gujarat, and I was really impressed the way they handled that. So this is there, you know, partly this was part of it. But I think NIDM is thinking little, you know, ahead. They are not talking about relief. They are talking inclusive. So inclusive means that in all aspects of disaster risk reduction, they should be included. In prevention, you know, I think prevention is in preparedness. When we are talking about that, animals are indicators. They are not only pollution indicators, you know, they are indicator for earthquake, they are indicator for landslide, they are indicator for... So I think we want that there should be a place in preparedness, in prevention, relief, they are already there. In rehabilitation, when we are talking about recovery, I think there should be a place for recovery this section, because without that you cannot talk about sustainability. When we are thinking of sustainable development goals, when we are talking about sustainable development, sustainability of any ecological system, I think in recovery phase, in rehabilitation phase also, we should keep this thing in mind. And this is important, basically. I welcome the earlier ED of NIDM, Mr. Satendra, the very senior IFS officer. And he came at the right time because he was the first one who initiated and wrote a book on forest fire and started, you know, working in NIDM on forest fire. In fact, forest fire cannot be, you know, the module cannot be prepared without the inclusive or inclusion of animals, basically. Friends, I think there are few things which is mentioned by Ms. Bharati. For example, when we are talking about wildlife, now we are thinking of corridors. And the Ministry of Environment and Forest, they have a very big project on biodiversity conservation, which is managed by UNDP. And they are also talking that snow leopard and all these things, you know, there should be corridors. And in these corridors, you know, these animals, because otherwise what happens, that now there is one more thing which is happening, that is the man-animal conflict. Because when the habitat change, these animals, you know, particularly wild animals, they come to, to the cities and to the urban areas. And this conflict starts. The same thing, you know, we have seen at different places, and now it is increasing because of urbanization, because of, you know, deforestation and all that. Climate change, I think there are few examples, and we will be discussing this because this is one day workshop, so I will be very brief. I will give you one or two examples only. One is about in Sikkim this year. And Ms. Bharati will, because she is also from the same cadre. In Sikkim, for the first time, 220 yaks, they died. And we were thinking, what happens? You know, this is their habitat. But then we find out that the area, you know, got more snow, and there was no grass to eat. And because of this, more than 200 yaks, and people, some people's villagers, they are saying it is more than 1,000. So this has happened for the first time in Sikkim. And this has added, burden on SSDMA, because we will have to give relief now to the farmers, because this is their livelihood. And without yaks, they are. So I think this kind of thing is happening. And the impact is obvious. Same thing is with the flooding. We have seen that now the floods are frequent, and the number of animal death is also increasing, in last couple of years. So I think I will say that this animal inclusive disaster risk reduction means that their inclusion in every aspect of the disaster management cycle, and when we prepare any plan or district plan, for example, or now we are going one step ahead, we are making panchayat level plans. So I think at that panchayat level plan, we should include all these aspects which are important. And that's why the discussion which is going to happen today in this one day workshop will be very relevant, will be a sort of give some guidelines to us so that these guidelines can be used in making the state plan, making or revising basically the district plan and panchayat plans. With these words, I thank NIDM for inviting me, and thank you all for listening this address. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sharma, for your insightful address for inclusive disaster risk reduction, why it is important, why animals should be included in all the phases of disaster management cycle. Thank you so much. Now we are coming to the end of this inaugural session, and I will request AD and IDM to honor our guests on the dais with offering plant pots. AD sir will honor our chief guest, Professor B.K. Sharma. AD sir will honor Shri Upmanyu Basu ji. Bharati, IG Forests. Now I will request Professor Gupta to honor our AD, Shri Manoj Bindal ji. First, our joint director and IDM, Sri Dinesh Vasishji, to honor Professor Gupta.